Right. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for joining us today for Neuroscience Ground Rounds. If you guys will see in the chat box, for those of you who are joining us today for CME credit, if you could please enter your name and your email into the chat section so that you can get credit for joining us today. So thank you for tuning in to Neuroscience Ground Rounds. For those of you who tune in regularly, you will have realized that I am not Dr. Wallavan Sivakumar. I am Natalie Diaz. I'm a neurologist that works at the Pacific Neuroscience Institute here at Little Company of Mary. I'm a movement disorder neurologist specialist working with our speaker today. So I'm very proud and honored to present him today and introduce him. Dr. Jean-Philippe Langevin is a board certified neurosurgeon. He is fellowship trained in functional neurosurgery. He is currently our director here of functional neurosurgery and director of the deep brain stimulation program here at Providence Little Company of Mary, as well as at Providence St. John's Medical Center in Santa Monica. Since 2012, he's also been the director of the surgical DBS program and the epilepsy program at the Greater Los Angeles VA on the West Side. Prior to this, he received his medical school education at McGill University in Canada. He then completed both residency and functional neurosurgery fellowship at UCLA. He has been an active researcher, and his area of research has been the application of neuromodulation to treat neuropsychiatric illness. He has been the principal investigator on several trials in this area, and most recently was awarded a Brain Initiative grant to study the effects of responsive neurostimulation for the treatment of PTSD. So we're honored to have him today, and he's going to be talking about neurostimulation for depression and anxiety.
Thanks, Natalie. Welcome, everybody. And thanks to the organizer to give me the chance to present this topic today. You know, it's really an exciting time. I feel privileged to be able to work, you know, in that field in functional neurosurgery, especially these days. As now the technology has improved tremendously, especially in the last 5 years, we've seen quite an acceleration. And at the same time, we're also seeing an improvement and an increase in the indications, you know, for surgery. And a lot of it is still on the research side. So today I'm gonna touch upon depression, anxiety, because those are probably the most active areas of research. They're offering a lot of promise, and it's also a critical problem in the society, right? So like we have treatment-resistant depression, which is a pretty common problem. So if you look at just depression in the United States, so the prevalence is about 30% for a lifetime. And currently with the COVID-19 pandemic, we're expecting that these numbers are gonna go up following the pandemic. And 9% yearly of new prevalence, you know, new patients diagnosed with depression. Fortunately, you know, we've seen a lot of improvement on the medication side, and about half of those patients with depression will respond at least after two trials of SSRIs. Nevertheless, about 30% of all patients will go on to suffer from treatment-resistant depression. So that's essentially defined as somebody who fails to respond after two antidepressant classes of medication. And failure to respond, meaning they don't achieve at least 50% reduction in their depression symptoms. So you can imagine that, you know, we're adding new depressed patients every year. Some of them are getting better, but then you're accruing about 30% more that are developing treatment-resistant depression. So over time, you know, certainly, if you're a psychiatrist or working into the mental health field, the treatment-resistant depression patients are, you know, gonna have like a large, it's gonna represent a large percentage of the patient population that you're treating. And so, you know, if we look at the medications, and so this slide is borrowed from LivaNova, that makes the vagal nerve stimulator that we're gonna be discussing today. But remission is much less likely once you fail two trials of medication. So majority of patients are going to respond after the first trial of SSRIs, and then a large percentage is also going to respond after the second trial. But then once you get to that third trial of medication, then there's a steep drop off. And as you can see, for the fourth trial, there's almost no one who's going to respond. And so, we need to think about new options. And so that's where we think that neurostimulation is going to play a critical role. And in order to try to understand how neurostimulation could play a role, it comes back to the question as where do we think depression comes from inside the brain? So we need to tackle depression from a different angle, different approach, basically. And so this is a critical work that was done by Ellen Mayberg a number of years ago. And so this, what we're looking at here is the PET scan combined from a multitude of patients. And on the left side, what she did is that she looked at the PET scan, the brain activity in patients before they responded to antidepressant and after they responded. So those are patients who recovered from depression. And what she found out is that those patients that responded to therapy had increased activity in sort of the dorsal frontal area of the brain, and they have a reduction in activity at the ventral part at the base of the brain, meaning that when they were depressed, these areas were highly active at the bottom of the brain, and then they shut down once the depression is alleviated, and vice versa, at the top of the brain, those areas were depressed at the beginning, and after the patient responds to medication, they become more active. And similarly, if you have a normal patient that you're inducing sadness, by presenting them perhaps with a sad movie or like a sad song, you're going to see just that picture where the dorsal areas of the brain are less active and the ventral areas of the brain are more active. And so she came up with this very influential model, basically, of how depression works, where you have this dichotomy of the dorsal areas that should be highly active in normal individual and the ventral areas that you would like to be less active. And in the center, sort of in the middle, so what we call area 24, acts as a so-called thermostat that determines where the activity is going to go. So sometimes it is appropriate to be more sad or to be so-called depressed. And so then it's going to shift the activity by reducing the dorsal activity and increasing the ventral activity. And when you have a happy moment, then the opposite happens. And the overall theory is that in depression, that thermostat is essentially not functioning properly, such that you have overactivity of the depressed network, basically. And another researcher, Elizabeth Murray, who works at the NIH, kind of gives us a hint as to why are those areas so critical in depression, right? What is it about the dorsofrontal prefrontal cortex and the ventral base of the brain, basically? What is it that those areas are managing in terms of information processing that would make sense that it's generating depression? And so what she did is she took, so in monkey research, basically she took those monkeys and introduced them to a special food that they like. So some monkeys could get some sweet food and A, and then another food B, that's equally palatable to the monkeys. And so what happens is that if you present the monkeys to both foods, so they'll select one versus the other, and then go back to the other one once they are at satiety to want one of the option. And what if you're presenting only to one of those options, right? So you're giving them, let's say, just the food number A, and you let them reach satiety with that food, then it should depreciate the value to that specific food. So then after that experiment, if you then expose them to both food, they should select the option B that they did not have to satiety to start. And so that's how the monkeys or the brain is assigning value to different stimuli. And so what she did is that introduced that model to the monkeys and then also created different lesions, right? So different lesions in the prefrontal areas on both sides, and then bilaterally in the amygdala, and then in tandem prefrontal cortex on one side and amygdala on the other side. And what they noticed is that there was no reassignment of the value. So like the monkey were still selecting food A or food B, you know, without discrimination, even when they were fed to satiety with option A, let's say. And so that means is that there's no assignment of value to any stimulus in the life of those monkeys after those lesions. And so imagine if you were to go by your life and you assign no value, either positive or negative, to stimuli and to activities that you're going to perform. So essentially, you have no motivation to do a specific activity versus doing nothing. So versus like watching TV or going to work, for example. In addition to that, you assign no value to yourself, you know, as your own internal stimulus. And so this general idea is that if you have a dysfunction in that network, you're essentially not able to assign value or to reassign value appropriately in your life. And so you're sort of wandering around without motivation. And so that's how we think depression arises in those individuals. So now that we know that, the idea is that, are there any ways that we can modulate that depression network, you know, aside from using medication? And so there are different therapies, you know, some of them that we know pretty well, like electroconvulsive therapy that's still in use nowadays. So like where the patient is essentially under almost like monitor anesthesia care, and they receive a high voltage shock to reset, so to speak, the brain activity. But more focally, people can undergo transcranial magnetic stimulation, which is an outpatient procedure where you modulate slightly the activity. And so what that does is that it increases the activity of the areas of the brain that are stimulated by this large magnet. And so remember, in my model, we said that the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex was deactivated inside the depressed patient. So you can then use this technology to improve the activity inside that area and then relieve the symptoms of depression. This other model here is direct transcranial stimulation. So it's using essentially electrical patches to induce electricity in a similar way, but instead of using a magnetic stimulation. Another option that we're going to be discussing today is vagal nerve stimulation. And so this is a relatively novel option that was approved by the FDA. But one of the advantage of VNS over these other options that I just show is that I can see these are like temporary options, right? So like for TMS, you need to go to the physicians to receive the treatment. When you go home, you're not, you know, the therapy is not ongoing. Obviously, CT is just a one-time deal, and you have to wait a long time before receiving it. And over time, you can have memory loss if you receive too many doses. And you know, nobody's going to walk around with those patches on the skull. So you can use it at home, but you know, you're limited into your social interactions. The idea of VNS is that it's an implantable system, as that you can see here, like the small generator. That's the actual size. Is located under the collarbone, and then you have the electrode that's hooked up to the vagal nerve. And then this therapy is chronically stimulating the nerve so that you have ongoing chronic therapy being delivered like at all time of the day. And so the question is, you know, why would this therapy that's outside the brain, you know, essentially would help you out in depression? And probably it's the same thing for you, but when I was in med school, you know, this is pretty much the representation that I had of vagal nerve, the vagal nerve activity, right? So you have this large nerve and it's providing autonomic stimulation to visceral organs inside the body. Like, so those functions are vitals, like, you know, managing the heartbeat, but also innervating the gut and the lungs. And so why would we be using this nerve, you know, to control depression? I mean, it makes no sense, right? So you're just controlling the viscera. But one thing that we're not as familiar with is that function that I just discussed, you know, of like the effector part of the nerve only represents about 20% of that large nerve. So if we look at the vagal nerve, it's more specifically, about 80% of the fibers are actually information that's coming into the brain, right? So like if we look at on the left-hand side here, a transection of the midbrain of the vagal nerve, you can see that not only one nucleus is innervated by the vagal nerve, but several ones. And especially, I would like you to focus on the nucleus of the solitary tract. And so these arrows are actually pointing in the wrong direction, where that information is not leaving the nucleus of solitary tract, but rather it's coming in from the rest of the body. And so I represent it here with a schematic, how the information flows into that large nerve, where you have like vagal nerve afferents. They land onto the nucleus of the solitary tract, and then you have a pretty widespread activity from there. Some fibers are handing into the insula that modulates, a lot of pain as well as emotion, especially in the interior part of the insula. A number of fibers are actually going into the reticular formation as well, and the bed nucleus of the stria terminalis. So that's like one of the main output of the amygdala. So needless to say that it manages a lot the emotional well-being as well. And then right in the center here, I represented the key part. So you have the dorsal raphe nuclei, which we know plays a critical role in depression. The locus coeruleus also plays a role in your level of activity and level of engagement. And the amygdala, which seems to be always playing a corner role into modulation of the emotions. And when we look at those areas, then they all converge into the medial prefrontal cortex. And when I added the neurotransmitters just to close the loop, as you can see, like the serotonin and norepinephrine, so there we go back into the antidepressant classes, right? And so you can see that through the vagal nerve stimulator, we're engaging like very critical pathways, either on the neurotransmitter side as well as to the regional network that are critical in depression. This is a schematic of that, where you have this patient implanted with a vagal nerve. The information lands onto the nucleus of the solitary tract. It then goes to the locus coeruleus, and then you have a widespread activation and modulation of those networks, that network that's involved in depression. And so this is results of some critical studies here that basically a meta-analysis of all the important clinical trials that have been done using vagal nerve stimulator for depression. And so it's a busy slide, but what I want you to focus on is the response rate over time. So those are patients who have improvement more than 50%. So at 6 months, 12 months, and 24 months. And so if you look at the beginning, not a whole lot of patients are responding to the therapy, and it may seem discouraging. But if you fast forward to 2 years out, you can see that you have a large proportion of patients at 55%. So those are patients who were treatment resistant to antidepressant, who then went on to have a response to VNS. Similarly, in remission, so this is probably even more important. So those are patients who actually accomplish remission after being treatment resistant to antidepressant. And again, at 2 years, you have almost 40% of those patients. And then I'm borrowing some slides again from LivaNova, the company, because they are focusing on this last study here by Aronson in 2017. And their representation, it really tells the story, where that's the benefit that you get with VNS plus treatment as usual, what they call TAU, versus just using treatment as usual. So if you go and fast forward at 60 months, you have this gain of responder and a remission rate again, at in excess of 20% at 60 months out, compared to just treatment as usual. So we're excited because at PNI, we're engaged now with this trial that's called RECOVER, using that technology for vagal nerve stimulator. It's actually, been approved by the FDA a number of years ago, but there were issues about reimbursement since CMS decided not to reimburse for the therapy. So a lot of people were interested in receiving VNS, but, it's prohibitive from a cost perspective. And basically CMS has decided to revisit this whole idea and give a second chance, so to speak, at vagal nerve stimulator. And so it will allow patients to enter the trial and being paid by Medicare for the device for the purpose of the study. And then at the end, we'll see, you know, if the results pan out like we believe they will. And so this is the study design. So in order to be covered by CMS, so like the patients need to enter the trial. So it's a randomized trial for the first 12 months where a group of patients will receive the device, but the therapy will not be initiated. Whereas the other group, you know, obviously the therapy will be initiated. And then there's a double blind study where the psychiatrists are evaluating the patients for their symptoms using the depression scale, like the Hamilton depression scale, and determine, you know, after this phase, if the patients are responders. And importantly, after the 12 months, then there's an open label portion of the clinical trial that will be initiated for an additional 4 years where all the devices are activated. And so that's critical, right? Because if you remember from that previous slide that I showed you, a lot of patients will start to show remission rate or response rate far out after the initiation of the therapy. And so it's possible that we don't see an effect at 12 months, but rather we have to wait a longer time. You know, however, from an ethical perspective, you know, how long can we really keep the device in a patient and receive the surgery without starting the therapy? So I think it makes sense to start it at 12 months. From a procedural or surgical aspect, the placement of VNS is a relatively simple procedure. So it's typically done into an outpatient surgical center so that the patients can go home the same day. But essentially, a small incision is made at the mid cervical area and under the collarbone. And then we identify the vagal nerve, and the electrode is wrapped essentially around the nerve, and the wire is then tunneled under the skin to reach the pulse generator under the collarbone. And just so in case anybody has patients to refer, I included the inclusion criteria in these slides. It's obviously borrowed from LivaNova. So some of the key inclusion criteria, so the patients need to be adult of age, and they need to obviously have depression or bipolar depression that's been chronic, you know, for more than 2 years. In terms of treatment resistance, the way it's described inside this trial is an insufficient response to more than four adequate trial of antidepressant treatment. And so that includes oral medications, as well as it could be transcranial magnetic stimulation, psychotherapy, or even ECT. So those patients who are bipolar will have to continue on their medication. So like I mentioned, you know, so we're excited about starting this trial. I feel it's a strong collaboration between the company LivaNova and CMS, you know, so in terms of trying to find new options for patients who are suffering for treatment-resistant depression. And actually, a lot of patients are looking for options that are non-medication related. So they want to try something that's different. And so I showed, you know, in these slides how like it makes sense conceptually that VNS could alter the activity within an important network involved in depression. And so now I want to spend time also talking about more intracranial neurostimulation. So like the first part there, using vagal nerve stimulation is actually legally not considered psychosurgery because in California, psychosurgery is defined as a surgery that's performed intracranially to alter behavior. So vagal nerve stimulation actually escapes that that legal definition, so that the patients don't need to go through the hoops, you know, of undergoing psychosurgery trial. So like in California, we still have a partial ban on psychosurgery from the 1950s, which means that the patients who undergo true psychosurgery need to be evaluated by three physicians who are independent of the treatment team. And those physicians then need to make sure that the patient is able to consent for the procedure and that they are indeed resistant to the gold standard therapy. So in deep brain stimulation, since it's an intracranial procedure, then that counts as a psychosurgical approach. And the example that I wanted to use is that of post-traumatic stress disorder, because that's an active area of research. You know, as Dr. Diaz said, I've been pursuing this project for a number of years. Currently, we're funded by the NIH. And it's also a significant problem in our society. So you remember that the United States has the largest PTSD population in the world because of all the armed conflicts, you know, that the country has gone through over the last several years. And those patients are suffering incredibly. So we occasionally hear on the news, you know, terrible stories involving PTSD patients. But essentially, to put everybody on the same page, PTSD occurs when a patient has been subjected to a life-threatening event, you know, in their life. And that event is so strong that it changes the way the fear circuitry functions inside the brain, such that the patient continues in their life having a vivid memory, reliving that event with constant flashback and reliving of the traumatic event. Because of the reliving event, the patients tend to avoid social situations because any social situations has a tendency to create a so-called trigger that's going to remind them of the event. So then they try to avoid social interactions. And hyperarousal, you know, relates to the nightmares, the sweating, like basically the stress response that's related to the PTSD syndrome. Approximately a third of our veterans, it might be higher now since the end of the Afghanistan conflict, but about 30%, at least in the era of the Vietnam War, had PTSD. And the cost to the U.S. government is extremely high because of the ongoing suffering of the patients. And fortunately, you know, similar to the case of depression, we have good treatments. So, you know, the patients can be treated with SSRIs and a combination with that with psychotherapy. And the majority, so about 70% of the patients will respond to that and do well. And so our research project obviously focuses on the other 30%, you know, similar to depression. It's always the rule of 30. So it seems that about 30% of the patients fail to respond to currently available therapy. And so those are the ones that we focus on. And I have a video here to show you, you know, what it means to live with PTSD. So like we have our psychiatrist here interviewing our patient to describe some of the symptoms that he's having. And you'll see how like he loses essentially the patient during the interview because of the severity of the symptoms.
And why do you want to participate in this study?
I need some relief from these dreams that I have and some of these hallucinations and these illusions. And then when I go inside, that's when I start to sketch and I try to stay awake.
Try to stay awake. What do you mean by that?
I just try to stay awake. I just try not to go to sleep.
You avoid going to sleep because?
I don't like to sleep.
Because of the nightmares?
Yeah.
All right. And have you ever been married?
No.
Would you like to be?
Yes.
Okay. And have you ever considered having children? Is that something you would like?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So tell me about what your life was like before you entered the service, Henry. Can you tell me what your life was like before you entered the service?
I went to school, graduated. I worked at an auto parts store, Pep Boys.
Mm-hmm. What did you do at Pep Boys?
I sold tires and batteries and auto parts.
Mm-hmm. Okay, how long did you do that for before you went to service? Henry, how long did you do that for before you went into service?
Like about 2 years, a year and a half, something like that.
And what was the quality of your relationship like before you went in the service? Henry?
So basically, you know, you can notice that he's no longer responding to our psychiatrist towards the end of the video. But also, you know, notice his demeanor, right? So from the get-go, his hands are inside his pocket. He's not really engaged with the interview. He's wearing sunglasses, you know, indoor. And you might wonder why he keeps on brushing his legs. And so basically the story behind this is that this patient was involved with the Iraqi conflict, the so-called like, Desert Storm conflict in the Highway of Death. And so that's a time when the troops from Iraq were trying to quit Kuwait and make their way back to Baghdad. And essentially the US forces, you know, so like wiped them out on the highway. So he was involved in this combat. And so on the next day, they went into recognition to see, you know, what happened to the enemy. And he saw there a huge amount of like dead soldiers that had charred body from the heavy artillery. And so since that time, he feels like the charred flesh like invades his body. So like he feels like haunted by that. So it's essentially a perpetrator guilt. And what he does there in periods of stress, you know, when our psychiatrist asks him about nightmares and sleeping, it's triggering those senses, so those memories. And then he feels like his body is getting engulfed into this dark, you know, charred flesh. And so he's trying to brush it off his body excessively and essentially just lose complete touch with what's going on around him. And so, you know, how those these symptoms occur, right? So it's, I want to make a parallel here for depression. So I started to talk, you know, saying, well, how does depression occur? Like, what's the network involved? And so similarly in PTSD, you know, researchers have done studies to figure out like where in the brain those symptoms are related to or where they occur. And this is an example here, a meta-analysis again in fMRI study where they had subjects with PTSD, they placed them into a functional MRI at rest. They scanned them and then they stressed them either with the sound of artillery or imagery of war, and they rescanned them. And so then you do one minus the other. And what happens is if you can see here, the red spots is like the amygdala that's lighting up tremendously under periods of stress, you know, during the symptomatic episodes. Another line of evidence is they look at the Vietnam combat vets. And so we know from the VA hospital system, like which ones had PTSD. And we also have a series of scans on those patients over the years, the ones that had traumatic brain injury. And what they did in that study is they look at combat vets who had traumatic brain injury, and they looked at the location of the trauma to the brain in relation to the occurrence of PTSD. And what they found on that first line is that if there was traumatic brain injury specifically to the amygdala, there was complete protection against PTSD. And so what we find out there is that the amygdala is critical not only to develop PTSD, but also to display the symptoms of PTSD later on in life. Rodent studies have then gone, you know, more into details about the amygdala to figure out like what's critical, what's happening inside the architecture of the amygdala to mediate symptoms of PTSD. And in rats, they found that if you look at the top left of this amygdala diagram, they found two populations of cell right next to each other, one that mediates fear and the other one that mediates extinction. So like essentially like the contrast right next to each other. And so that provides the basic architecture or machinery, if you will, to generate the symptoms of PTSD. And so it's a little bit as if you have like a receptive feel in the visual area where different emotions are being contrasted right next to each other. So you have fear and fear extinction, you know, mediated by neurons that are closely associated and that are connected to various areas of the prefrontal cortex. At any point in time, in that population of cells, you may have more fear cells that are active or more extinction cells that are active. I'll give you an example. So let's say you're at home, it's Friday night, you're alone, it's dark, and you decide to go on Netflix and play in a horror movie. So I don't need to tell you that most likely your fear cells are going to be more active than your extinction cells. And so in that case, you're going to have that receptive feel at the bottom right here, you know, so like where you have more fear cells population that are activated or near activation than the extinction cells. which means that if at that point in time your loved one comes in and gently brushes your shoulder, you're likely that you're going to startle at that point. So imagine, so basically that's what PTSD patients have, but throughout their life. So for them, they're unable to go from a situation where they have the bottom receptive field back to a normal situation where they have the top one, where you have more extinction cells being active. So it's sort of a situation where you're stuck in a fear state. So we tested the hypothesis that perhaps if we use deep brain stimulation into the basal lateral amygdala that contains those fear cells, we might be able to reduce the amount of fear in those patients with PTSD. So the idea is that PTSD patients are stuck into a fear state because there are too many fear cells active. Now we know from our clinical experience with movement disorder that when we use deep brain stimulation, we can reduce the activity of specific spots inside the brain. So now we know that fear is activated mostly in the amygdala, might as well try to reduce the activity in that region to see if the symptoms get better. So in this rodent model, we placed the DBS into the amygdala, the deep brain stimulation electrode. The rat was then shocked, you know, so like inescapable shock inside that cage. And they were presented with their cue object, which is gonna be our trauma reminder down the line. So we did one session of those inescapable shock, and then for 7 days, the rat does not see that tennis ball anymore. So they're just in their regular cage, and they're hooked up to an external generator every day. Half the rats received the DBS, the other half, they were hooked up but did not receive the DBS. And so I just have the videos, you can see what happens. 7 days later, we then put the tennis ball back into the batting cage of the rodent to see how they're reacting to it. And so you can see that the rat on the left side is the one that has received the DBS therapy for 7 days. So he was presented to the inescapable shock. The tennis ball was there as a cue reminder. But during those 7 days, we modulated this amygdala so that he forgot about this fear or this trauma that's happened to him. And so now when he's presented with the tennis ball again, he's displaying a normal behavior, which means that, you know, he's sniffing the ball, being playful with it and trying to figure out what it is, you know, what he can do. Is it food? Like, is it what kind of object is it? On rat B, that rat was also subjected to inescapable shock, was then attached to the generator, but did not receive the therapy. So that rat remembers that tennis ball as a trauma reminder, so he wants to push it under the bedding as much as possible and forget about it. And so what we did in this experiment is we measured the time that the rat spends burying that ball, as simply as that. And so these were the results. So like you can see at baseline, none of the rats are burying the ball. Then 1 week after the shock, when we present the ball, the rats that were treated sham, so that did not receive the therapy, spent a lot of time burying the ball, and so were the control, or even the rats treated with an SSRI Paxil. But the rodents that were treating with DBS displayed a marked reduction in that behavior. And then we repeated again at 2 weeks, where we did a crossover design where the rats that received sham were then treated with DBS. And what we learned is that basically, two things. The rats that received the DBS therapy for the first week but did not receive it for the second week had a carryover effect where their benefits were maintained and even improved, which means that when they've learned not to be fearful of the ball, they memorize that, and then the benefits carried over. And more importantly, the rats who did not receive the therapy initially and then displayed the PTSD behavior, once we started the DBS late, they also benefited from the therapy. So that's the situation of our veterans that have chronic PTSD, and then we're initiating DBS at that point in time. And so this just shows here what we're trying to accomplish in those patients where, you know, the 4th of July is very difficult for our veterans in the US because we see fireworks, but they see a trauma reminder of improvised explosive device from Iraq, and that engages their fear circuitry. And our goal is to use the DBS, like on the top left side, to engage an extinction state so that they can enjoy the fireworks like all of us. So this was our first patient. As you know, we established a response rate at 30% reduction in PTSD symptoms. And the patient responded, fortunately, to the therapy. He also reported that his nightmares got better almost pretty quickly after initiation of stimulation. We currently have two patients that have completed between 2 years to now 4 years of chronic stimulation and have essentially achieved about 50 to 60% reduction in their PTSD symptoms. But what I wanted you to notice on the top graph is how much ups and downs, you know, we are going through with this therapy, right? So it's not a linear improvement where you start high and then, you know, there's chronic improvement throughout the course. So there's a lot of like deterioration in those periods, meaning that the patient is reporting more symptoms, perhaps even suicidal ideations. And so these are periods that are extremely stressful. And so that relates to the limitations of our strategy of using a simple DBS, which means that we place, just going to show, we place the device that you see in that veteran on the left side under the collarbone. It's hooked up to the electrodes and there's a continuous stimulation of the amygdala. And so there are several limitations related to this therapy. And the first one is that we don't really know what the right parameters are. So like the patients come in after the surgery, we start the stimulation. So where do we place the amplitude, the frequency? So, you know, we don't have any immediate feedback where the patient tells us like, oh, I feel so much better now that you adjusted the stimulation. In movement disorder, you know, we have the advantage of seeing the patient's tremor get better almost immediately in our office or the rigidity of their arm. But in psychiatry, we don't have that luxury. The other thing is we cannot predict the clinical outcomes in the near future or the long-term future. So we don't know if we're on the right track. So we don't know if we have the right parameters and we don't really know if the stimulation is engaging the network sufficiently. And we can't tell the patient, you know, we think that with 70, 80% chance, like in 1 year, you're going to be a lot better. We also don't know when it's time to start psychotherapy. So at some point in time, the patient is going to be able to engage their extinction network sufficiently that we can resume psychotherapy and the psychologist can expose them to their trauma gently to start. And so that's really going to boost the improvement. But we don't really know if it's too early or if we're right on time that we can start engaging the extinction network. And finally, we don't really know what the time frame of those improvement. Should we be looking at a 1 year time frame or 2 years? Like, how do we know where we are on the spectrum of the patient on his way to getting better? And essentially, what we're missing is an objective marker of improvement, right? So we're only relying on the patient coming in every month and telling us how they've been doing in the last month. Like, are they feeling better, less anxious? Like, are they seeing their friends more often? And so we're stuck with that subjective scales. And we believe that, you know, basically a biomarker looking at the neuronal activity will be able to provide us a real-time information that's objective to solve a lot of those issues. First of all, if you have a marker of the symptoms inside the brain, well, every time we use the electricity, we can then look back and see if we were successful at abolishing that signal. So we have a direct feedback of whether or not our stimulation is successful at accomplishing its goal and if it's engaging the network. At the same time, it solves the issue of chronic stimulation. So with chronic stimulation, we're continuously affecting that small area of the brain, and that can be counterproductive. So it's better perhaps to use on-demand stimulation and stimulate only when you need it. And finally, the device would be able to record the number of those detections, you know, those biomarker signals over the course of a month so that every month when you see the clinician in their office, they'll be able to look at the occurrence of those biomarkers to determine if you're on the right track or, you know, conversely, if things are getting worse. And so we did some recording in our patients prior to inserting final DBS electrode. And we did find a putative biomarker in a low frequency range that seems to be related to when the patient is seeing negative images. So we just have the patient with the electrode in place, and then we present them with images on our laptops, some of which are pleasant, like flowers or people playing. And other ones might be reminders of their trauma, so like, you know, war imagery. And then we look at the signals inside the brain in the amygdala. And so we did find a biomarker that's predictive of when the patient is seeing those negative images. And so our goal now is to move towards a next generation implant that's called responsive neurostimulation, where the electrodes are still located in the amygdala, but this time are hooked up to this small pulse generator, you know, inside the skull. And that's acting both as a computer to monitor the brain activity continuously. It detects the abnormal signal, and then it emits a signal to basically abolish those abnormal signal. And so this is what it looks like. You know, the technology was created for epilepsy, where it detects seizures, you know, so you place the electrode inside the seizure focus, and it detects when you have the abnormal activity starting of a seizure, and it emits a small amount of electrical current to abolish those seizures. And so we have, just advance a little bit here, where it's going to show you the rhythm strip in real time, where you have the normal activity in blue. And then in red here is going to be the detection, meaning the abnormal signal. And then in green is the device basically emitting that signal to abolish the abnormal detection. And as you can tell here, we have that exact snapshot transmitted by the device. So we know if the stimulation was successful at abolishing that abnormal signal. So we're basically treating PTSD as a small seizure in this case. And then every month we get access to this information that's stored inside the device and transmitted through the cloud. And then you have this printout showing like how many detections the device had recorded over the month. And we can tell whether or not the patient is getting better with the therapy. And so just before I take some question, I just wanted to show you to finish here this video of the same patient. This was done, I would say about like a year and a half after the initiation of the stimulation. And it's just to show the reason as to why, you know, we want to do this research. Like, and so the patient kind of explains some of the benefits, you know, that he had with the therapy. Like, did he feel it made him feel better? Was there any problems? And so I'm going to accelerate because the video is 3 minutes, but I'm going to go through it here. But you can see also his demeanor, see how more relaxed he is.
Prior to this surgery, I suffered a lot with really bad night terrors, like really bad. Now, this past summer of 2015, for me, it's been it's been the most calmest summer I've had since I can remember in my adult life. You know, I don't remember having any of those night terrors that I've had all these years. One of the things that I would do, Dr. Cook, you know, before the surgery, though,
right,
it's important. Mm-hmm. Before the surgery, like when it was time for me to go to bed, I would jump onto the bed. I would jump onto the bed because wow. I felt that these arms were going to reach out from underneath and take me under. So I would jump onto the bed.
Yes.
So I would jump onto the bed.
Right.
This summer, I haven't experienced that.
Wow.
So now it's more like I'm able to, you know, like 11:30, 12 o'clock midnight, I'm able to get, you know, into some sleep clothes, and I'm able to just go to my, you know, I pray every night. Mm-hmm. And I am able to just to kind of sit down on my bed and just bring my body down. I'm still, you know, still a little stressed out. Don't get me wrong. I still am stressed out, but it's not like I got to throw myself on the bed.
Wow.
And then the sleep though, as far as sleep, I will say it's more consistent, and mm-hmm. I'm more calm, and I'm more restful in the morning.
With your family?
It's better. I remember how close mm-hmm. to how much I cared before the DBS.
Wow, that sounds profound.
It is.
And it means a lot to me.
Yeah, I know.
It means a lot to me.
I hear that.
I really care about that.
Have you noticed any other benefits of the treatment that you can put your fingers on or that come to mind?
Well, the biggest thing is I'm calm, you know? And because I'm calm, all the other areas of my life have opened up: employment, my hobbies, my relationship with my family, you know, and also not dwelling on what I experienced in Iraq. So because I'm calm now, it has opened up a lot of areas for me. So that would be the biggest thing. Prior.
So just in conclusion, before taking a questions, you know, what I hope to convey in this discussion is that the symptoms of psychiatric conditions, you know, we believe arise from network activity that are mismatched to the environment. So in PTSD, for example, the network activity might be very reasonable in a combat zone, right, where everything needs to be feared. But in a normal society, obviously, if you live like that, it's going to represent a mismatch and you're going to miss out on a lot of important social interactions. The second thing that's a tenet of like the neurostimulation for psychiatric disorder is that it takes time to see the benefits. And that's critical because if you place the outcomes of your clinical trial too early and then you're hoping to see benefits quickly, your trial may fail when indeed it should succeed. You know, and I remember having this conversation with a device maker who told me, I really want you guys to come up with a therapy that's going to be 70% an improvement in symptoms right away, like a switch. And unfortunately, in psychology, it doesn't work like that. So we can engage, the hope is that we can engage the network, but then it takes time for the patient to do a lot of work on themselves to then show the benefit. And so initially you have some modulation at the level of the network, but then it's only later on that you'll see the benefit in terms of years. And that latency is most likely related to the severity of the condition, as well as how long the patient has been suffering from the condition. So the longer you've been suffering, the longer it's gonna take to get better. And during that time when you're getting better, it's not going to be a smooth ride. So unfortunately, there's a lot of ups and downs. It's very volatile. And finally, the neurostimulation should not be considered a standalone therapy. And there, you know, for me, it's an analogy to what we do in spine surgery. So, you know, if someone has a sprain in their back, you know, they throw in their back, we don't need to do surgery. So they can get better. The structure of the back is still intact. And so they can do physical therapy. They get right back on their feet. However, if somebody has gone through an extensive motor vehicle accident and they have a big fracture and you subject them to physical therapy, they are going to tell you they feel worse because the back is structurally unsafe, unstable. And so that patient needs surgery first to fix the structural problem. However, doing the surgery itself is not sufficient, because if you do a surgery and the patient stay in bed saying like, well, maybe my pain feels better, but I'm not sure, you're not gonna see any functional improvement. That's where you need your colleague from physical therapy to come in, get the patient out of bed and start to have them walk so that you can actually record the improvement. The same thing goes with neurostimulation. So you place the DBS in. If the patient does not go back to socially engage with their peers, their loved ones, go back to work, you're not going to see the improvement. Functionally, they're still going to be at home doing nothing. So that's where we need to have the neuromodulation to change the network and engage extinction network for PTSD, and engage the value network for depression. But then you need the psychotherapy to guide the patient to reintroduce those activities so that you can capture all the benefits. So thank you for your attention, and I'll take any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Langevin. That was a great talk, and definitely, you know, important in this sort of unmet need that's seen in veterans as well as people with, you know, medication-resistant depression. So we have a couple questions here. Let me start with, somebody asked, what are the side effects of the device, these devices, especially the ones with the amygdala on the autonomic nervous system? Are there any side effects like that?
Yeah, so yes, the question on side effect, you know, both I can touch base on VNS and on DBS of the amygdala. So on VNS, you know, some of the side effects that we see are could be like voice change, because there's could be stimulation that affect the vocal cords. And sometimes the patients can report almost like a choking sensation when the stimulation is too high. Fortunately, those are typically modulation related, meaning that by adjusting the programming parameters, you can eliminate and program around, you know, the side effects. So it's not something where it happens and it's fixed in time. So you can do something about it to eliminate them. In terms of the DBS and of the amygdala, we haven't seen any consistent, you know, side effect. It does appear to me that perhaps some patients are experiencing change in the flavor of food. And some food that was palatable to them before may have a change in meaning temporarily as we start the stimulation, but it tends to normalize over time so that there's no weight loss. And then I see, as part of that question, I see whatever happened to the previous study on VNS on CVA. And so that was a different company than LivaNova studying the effect of VNS for stroke. And that study is wrapped up now. We're completing the final stage where we're still following those patients. However, the company had enough data to go to the FDA. You should see a publication shortly, I believe in Lancet, and you know, it's going to be promising some for those patients.
Great. And then somebody asks a few questions on the influence that VNS might have. So one twofold. One is, does it have any effect on drugs that are currently being taken? I'm assuming they're asking, you know, is there a reduction in any of the other medications that there might be on for depression? And then they also ask, does it have any influence on gut bacterial flora?
Yeah, so that's an interesting question. So first of all, you know, the one on the drugs taken, the patients will continue the same medications than prior to enrollment in the trial. But remember that a lot of those patients are treatment resistant. So oftentimes they will come into us on no meds because they failed all of them. That could be part of the influence. The nice thing about VNS is that you can continue the other adjunct therapy. So with any neurostimulation, you can continue meds. But oftentimes you're limited into alternative therapy like TMS or even ECT. In the case of VNS, they allow you to continue with treatment as usual, meaning that, you know, if you had ECT, you can continue with that. If you had TMS, you can continue with that, even if you have the implant in place. In terms of the gut bacterial flora, I'm actually not sure. That's a really interesting question. I'm not familiar with any studies that have been done on that. The one that I'm aware of is that another company has used low intensity chronic VNS stimulation for the treatment of chronic inflammation in the body. So like, you know, trying to modulate the immune system through low grade VNS stimulation. So that you know, something else that perhaps could be useful in rheumatoid arthritis or other ailments.
Great. And we have a couple of great questions here. Somebody asks, in your VNS study, are you collecting data on what the trigger is of their major depressive disorder? Maybe looking at outcomes depending on what the trigger might have been, if it's post-stroke depression or cancer-related depression, to see if there's a differential sort of treatment response.
Yeah, so that's a really interesting question. I believe that those demographics, you know, and historical data are going to be maintained as part of the study. But I think it'll be really interesting. Another one that's going to be critical is to know how long the patient has been suffering, right? So like if somebody has had depression postpartum, versus somebody who's had depression since childhood, you know, it's going to be interesting. Like I said, I think the latency of response is going to be longer if you've had depression for a longer period of time. So that, that also plays a role in the onset, you know, like when it started and why it started.
And here's an interesting question. So somebody asked, the amygdala mediates both fear extinction as well and contains separate cell populations which respond to both appetite and aversive. Do you think your stimulation works via inhibition of aversive cells or stimulation of appetite cells?
Well, the short answer to that is we don't know. From clinical experience using DBS at the same frequency that we're using in PTSD, most likely what we're doing is shutting down or functionally inactivating the fear cells. So like, you know, the idea is that it's so-called frequency jamming where you're basically introducing a monotonous, continuous white noise in the background, rendering those neurons meaningless, such that the other areas of the brain learn to discount what that area of the brain says. They're basically saying like, this is essentially like a TV channel that's meaningless, so you just discount what it says. In general, in DBS, it's difficult to drive forward a system. So like you have to use low frequency and it's usually not that successful. So in general, we believe that we're actually reducing the activity of hyperactive or bursting neurons.
Right, and maybe we'll take a last question. Are there any other psychological conditions that can be treated similarly?
There's several things under investigations. You know, for example, there's another very active trial using the RNS, the system that I showed, you know, with the generator in the skull. So for obesity, where, you know, what they're doing is presenting the patients with very palatable food by a virtual reality or in person, you know, so like a food carousel, so to speak. And so they're trying to figure out the trigger when the patient is having a food craving and trying to eliminate that to treat obesity on the addiction side of things. The depression trials are still active and ongoing. The first ones the results were not positive, perhaps because of a time frame issue. So that's still ongoing. Other people are looking at frank addiction, you know, like cocaine, alcohol addiction using DBS. And so I'd say that there's a wide variety of conditions that are currently being studied with neuromodulation. And so that's why it's an exciting time, you know. Obviously, it has to be done under strong ethical review so that we don't repeat errors of the past. But certainly, we at least have tools where this time the treatment is reversible and modulatable so that we're not creating permanent lesions.
Great, okay. We'll take a few more here. Somebody asks, are you aware of any stimulation studies with intractable hiccups?
That's been done and it's been disappointing. So VNS actually has been used, and so there's some reports in the literature for chronic hiccups with very marginal results, you know, where you implant a VNS for somebody with chronic hiccups. In general, I would say that with chronic hiccups, it's really important to have a thorough psychological evaluation if you're going to do anything about it, because oftentimes what you'll find is that there's comorbid depression or anxiety in addition to that. In that sense, perhaps VNS could play a role, but I would counsel the patient that it's mostly going to be on the depression side rather than treating the hiccup directly.
Okay, I think you may have already answered this about turning on and not turning on, but somebody asks, are you doing a sham procedure as part of your study?
Yeah, so in terms of sham, you know, we're not doing sham operation where somebody undergoes surgery and they are lured or fooled, you know, where they have like a scar with nothing done. So the nice thing about neuromodulation is that you can turn a device on or off, or you can turn the device on at extremely low subthreshold voltages. So you have different ways to create a so-called sham group. And in all those studies that we are doing or other people are doing, you know, the patients who are undergoing so-called sham treatment will have that for a period of time, and then they go back into active therapy. And I think it's really critical to judge how much time you're gonna keep patients in the sham group based on how severe their condition is. And so for us in PTSD, for example, we have a very short sham because we felt strongly that it was unsafe for the patients to keep them in that group for too long, you know, with so undergoing the stress and the risk of surgery without having the potential benefit from the stimulation. So our sham group is pretty short. So it affects the science of the results, but you know, it's done at a cost to maintain the safety of the candidates.
Right, and I guess one last question, since we're over time here. Somebody asks, what specific tests are you using to image the amygdala? Are you using PET or SPECT? And if so, what tracer are you using?
Currently, we're using a PET scan. What I would like to use is fMRI, but we're limited because the devices are not cleared to be used in a MRI scanner, especially under the fMRI condition. So that's why we're using PET, so we don't have to be limited by the magnetic field. And then I see one last question about mind-altering drugs in cannabis, you know, instead of VNS for all those psychiatric conditions. And so that's a really cool question because, you know, that's very active and a very exciting field of research currently. So where especially a psychedelic at low dose are going to be assisting patients through psychotherapy. And, you know, it's not a competition between the different modalities. I think we're all trying to do the same thing where using medication, mind-altering drugs, you know, or different types of devices, external or internal, what we're trying to do is to modulate those networks that I was talking about to reduce the mismatch activity. And so the idea here is that some of those psychedelic medication like MDMA might be used to put the patient into a state where they can extinguish their fear. So whereas a patient was unable to participate in psychotherapy for PTSD, you know, after receiving psychedelic meds, they might be able to sit through a session and start feeling better. And as I showed in the rats, you know, if you learn to extinguish fear, it's something that might be permanent where that learning carries over time. So I think it's exciting.
Dr. Diaz, if I can interject, I'm getting a couple of quick questions here. Dr. Langevin, that was incredible. For the referring providers who are still in the audience, what advice would you give them in terms of diseases they could potentially refer to you for discussions about neurostimulation procedures as they stand right now?
Yes, currently I'd say that twofold, the ones that are approved by the FDA. So I'd say for depression, you know, so we could offer the patients vagal nerve stimulation, especially if they qualify under this trial, so they would be able to enter a trial based on those criteria. And the other therapy that's received a partial FDA approval is deep brain stimulation for intractable obsessive compulsive disorder. So that's something else that we could offer for those patients that are very high in the spectrum of OCD, essentially like you know, where it's taking over their life, they can't get out of their house because of constant checking.
Very good. Okay, well, I think we've run out of time, gone over time now. So thanks very much, JP. That was a wonderful talk, very interesting. And definitely, you know, there's a great unmet need in these populations. So. Thank you everybody for joining today. I think we answered most of our questions there, if not all. Great. Thank you, everybody.
Thanks. Bye.
Thank you.